मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज 11th क्लास बायोलॉजी चैप्टर 6 एनाटॉमी ऑफ फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स एंड दिस इज लेक्चर नंबर 1 ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। टॉपिक्स टू बी डिस्कस्ड इन टुडेज लेक्चर आर द टिश्यूज, इन विच वी विल स्टडी अबाउट मेरिस्टेमेटिक टिश्यूज एंड परमानेंट टिश्यूज। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, दिस चैप्टर इज एनाटॉमी ऑफ फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स, सो यू नीड टू नो व्हाट इज एनाटॉमी। So anatomy is the study of internal structure of plants and other organism. Okay, in anatomy we study the internal structure of plant and any other organism. So here you can see this is the internal structure of plant. Okay, part of plant is shown here. So all the cells look like this. So this is anatomy. Now, what is the tissue? So, a tissue is a group of cells having common origin and function. The cells which originate from a common place and having similar function combinedly makes a tissue, right? Based on the capability of cell division, plant tissues are divided into two groups. Okay, so these two groups of tissues are based on the capability of cell division in these tissues, and these two groups of tissues are meristematic tissues and permanent tissues. Now let's see what is meristematic tissue. So meristematic tissues, these are the tissues where active cell division and growth occurs. Active cell divisions means cells present in this tissue are actively dividing, are fastly dividing cells. Okay, so active cell division occur in meristematic tissues. Now based on the position, meristems are three types. Meristematic tissues are of three types: apical meristematic tissue, or you can say apical meristem, intercalary meristem, and lateral meristem, that is also called secondary meristem. Okay, now see, you can see here, like this is a plant. So this upper, on the uppermost position, this is apical meristem. Here in this region, intercalary region, this is intercalary meristem and this is lateral meristem. Okay, apical meristem. So apical meristem occur at the tips of roots and shoots and produce primary tissues. So see here, this is apical meristem, and this type of apical meristem are found on the tip of both root and the shoot. So these are the tip of root and shoot. So we can say apical meristem is of two types: root apical meristem and shoot apical meristem. Now let's see here about the root apical meristem. So root apical meristem occupies the tip of a root. Okay, now you know about the part which is present at the tip of root. This is the root part of the plant. Okay, and at the tip here, this part is root cap. Okay, and just above the root cap, this part is root apical meristem. So this is root apical meristem. Here also you can see this is root part of the plant. This is root cap and here it is root apical meristem, right? And in the center, the central most part, this is central cylinder, that is also called procambium. Okay, and just outside the central cylinder part of the root, this is cortex, which is also called ground meristem. Okay, so you need to learn about these layers of the root, because here we are studying about the anatomy of the plants. Okay, so internal structure of the plant. So some parts name are given here. Okay, so central most part is central cylinder. Outside that, this is cortex, which is called ground meristem, and outside that, outside the cortex, this is protoderm. Okay, this is protoderm. So these are parts of root. Okay, now you can see here also about the root apical meristem. So this part is root cap. Okay, and here These are initials of root cap, because the root cap will arise from here, this part. So we can say these are some cells which are called initials of root cap, means the cells which gives rise to root cap. Okay, initials of root cap means the cells which gives rise to root cap. Okay, and just above these root cap cells, or the initials of root cap, this part is here. You can see these cells, these are meristematic cells, or you can say this is root apical meristem. Okay, and as you have seen here in this diagram, all these part, the central cylinder, protoderm and the cortex, these parts you can see here also. So this central part is the central cylinder, around both side of it this is cortex part, and the outermost part means outside of the cortex, this part is protoderm. Okay, so this is protoderm. You need to make only this diagram out of all these. Okay, so make this diagram in your notebook. Now next is shoot apical meristem. So for shoot apical meristem also you need to do this diagram. Okay, and here shoot apical meristem occupies the distant most region of the stem axis. So stem axis, distant most region means at the tip of stem. Some cells left behind from shoot apical meristem constitute the axillary bud. So these cells are forming axillary bud. These are the cells left behind from shoot apical meristem. Like this is shoot part, this is tip of the shoot. Okay, and this is the growing portion of the shoot, okay, which are making the leaf. Right, now this part of the shoot apex is left behind. When this part is growing, this part is left behind. So this left behind part is making axillary bud, right? And where these axillary buds are present? These are present in the axils of leaves and can form a branch or a flower. Okay, like you see here, this is the tip of the plant. Now from here these leaves arise. Okay, so this is called leaf primordium. Primordium means the previous structure which later on form a leaf. Okay, the structure which form a leaf later on is called leaf primordium. And here in the axil of this leaf you can see this part. Okay, the left behind cells or the part in the axil of leaf is called axillary bud, because it is present in the axil of leaf. That's why this is called axillary bud, right? And this axillary bud part can give rise a flower, means a flower can arise from here, or a branch of the tree can be formed from here, right? Now you can make this diagram easily, because shoot apical meristem tissue, first of all you make here, then this leaf primordium you will make. Okay, in the axil of leaf you will make the structure like this, that is axillary bud. And this is this part on both sides, this is differentiating vascular tissue. Okay, so first of all you start here with the tip, make this tip part of the stem, then these leaves, okay, leaf primordium. Then in the axil, show the axillary bud. On both sides, you make the differentiating vascular tissue. So make this diagram also in your notebook. This type of meristem is intercalary meristem. And here in this diagram, you can see the position of intercalary meristem. Like it is present here at the base of node. Like see in this diagram, this is stem. Okay, these are nodes from where leaf arises. Okay, and here at the base of node you can see here, this is intercalary meristem, and this one also is intercalary meristem. So intercalary meristem occur between mature tissues, right? And these intercalary meristem occur in grasses and help in regeneration of parts. So these regenerate parts removed by the grazing herbivores, means grazing animals,
when they destroy the grasses. So this intercalary meristem part present between the mature tissues help in regeneration of parts. As you can see here, these are intercalary meristem. This part is node, okay, and this complete part is internode, from one node to another node. And here at the base of node, this part, this portion is intercalary meristem, okay. And from this intercalary meristem, a new part can arise. Now, primary meristem. So, apical meristem you have studied, and also intercalary meristem you have studied, and you know the position of both. So, apical meristem and intercalary meristems are primary meristems because they appear early in a plant life and contribute to the formation of primary plant body, right? These are called, both the apical and the intercalary meristems are called primary meristem because they appear early in a plant life and contribute to the formation of primary plant body, means in its early life cycle. During that, specific regions of the apical meristem produce dermal tissues, ground tissues and vascular tissues. So during this early life cycle of the plant, apical meristem region produce dermal tissues, ground tissues and vascular tissues. About these tissues also you will study in this chapter later on, okay. Now next type of meristem is secondary meristem or lateral meristem. And you see here the position of lateral meristem. This is lateral meristem present here. The meristem that occur in mature regions of roots and shoots. Okay. So lateral meristem or the secondary meristem occur in the mature regions of roots and shoots. They are cylindrical meristem because they are present here and they are responsible for the increase in girth of the plant. And they are present here like in a cylindrical position. So these are cylindrical meristem. They are seen in gymnosperms and dicots. In monocots, they are lateral meristem is not present. Okay, so they are seen in gymnosperms and dicotyledonous plants. For example, fascicular vascular cambium, interfascicular cambium, and cork cambium. For now, you just learn the name. Okay. And later on in this chapter, you will learn about these also, about that what is the fascicular vascular cambium, what is interfascicular cambium, means exactly where these are present, okay. These are secondary meristem, fascicular vascular cambium, interfascicular cambium and cork cambium. These are secondary meristem. Later on in this chapter, you will study that where exactly these are present, okay. These are responsible for producing the secondary tissues. So all these, because these are lateral meristem, so we can say that these, or the lateral meristem is responsible for producing the secondary tissues. Okay, why this meristem is called secondary meristem? Because it is present, it is not present in the early life cycle of the plant. Okay, it appear in the plant later on its later stage of its life cycle. That's why it is called secondary meristem or lateral meristem, and it helps in increasing the girth of the plant, and it helps in the secondary growth of the plant, right. Now permanent or mature tissues. So you have studied about the meristematic tissues and the types of meristematic tissues. Now our next topic is permanent tissues or mature tissues. The cells produced by primary and secondary meristems. You know about the primary and secondary meristems now? Both apical and the intercalary meristem are called primary meristem. And you know about secondary meristem also, okay? So, the cells produced by primary and secondary meristems become structurally and functionally specialized. Okay, means they attain a specific structure and a specific function. So they structurally and functionally get specialized. and lost the ability to divide. Means, you know, in the meristem, in the apical meristem, intercalary meristem, so in the meristems, cells are actively dividing. But when the cells lose their ability to divide and become structurally and functionally specialized, they make mature tissues or permanent tissues, right? So they are called permanent cells or the permanent or the mature cells and constitute the permanent tissues, right? So such cells which have lost their ability to divide and have become specialized structurally and functionally are called permanent or mature cells, and a group of such cells make permanent tissues. Now these permanent tissues are of two types, simple permanent tissues and complex permanent tissues. First is simple permanent tissues. The tissues having all cells similar in structure and function. So there are two types of permanent tissues, simple and complex. In simple permanent tissues, all the cells are similar in their structure and function, right? And simple permanent tissues are of three types, parenchyma, collenchyma and sclerenchyma. So let's start with parenchyma first. Parenchyma, it forms major component within organs, major component within the organs of plant. Okay, cells are generally isodiametric, so this is isodiametric shape is found in parenchyma tissue. They may be spherical, oval, round, polygonal or elongated. Okay, so shape is variable. As you can see here, these are parenchyma tissue. Okay, and you can see the shape of cells here, right? Their walls are thin. Now you see here, this is wall of the cells. Okay, and these cells are having thin cell wall. So walls of the cells of the parenchyma tissue is thin and made up of cellulose. So their cell wall is made up of cellulose. Cells are closely packed or have small intercellular spaces. So you can see here, these are closely packed cells, okay, or very small intercellular spaces can be found. As you can see here, these intercellular spaces means the space found between the cells, okay. So small intercellular space can be present. These are the characteristic features of parenchyma tissue. Now, what is the function of parenchyma tissue? First function is photosynthesis. Because these the cells of parenchyma tissue contain chlorophyll. So these cells help in photosynthesis. Chlorophyll is the pigment responsible for the photosynthesis, right? So these cells help in photosynthesis. Also, they help in storage of food. So food is stored here in the parenchyma tissue, and also secretion of useful substances for the plant. So these are functions of parenchyma tissue. Here you can see all these are cells of parenchyma tissue. Okay, like in, this is epidermis, this is a structure of leaf. Here this is cross section of the leaf, this is leaf, and you can see all the layers of leaf here. So this uppermost layer is epidermis, and just below the epidermis, this is palisade mesophyll, means the different type of cells in the leaf. These are palisade mesophyll and these are spongy mesophyll. Okay, and all these are having, you can see this green color, so these are parenchyma tissue and these have chlorophyll within. Okay, so these cells help in photosynthesis, right? About this palisade mesophyll and spongy mesophyll also you will study later on in the anatomy of leaf in the same chapter. Next type of tissue is collenchyma. Okay, collenchyma occurs in layers below the epidermis in the dicot plants. So it is present below the epidermis in dicot plants. It is found as a homogeneous layer or in patches. So it can be a continuous homogeneous layer or it can be found in patches, means somewhere it is present, somewhere it is absent. So like in patches it can be present.
It consists of cells with much thickened corners due to deposition of cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin. So at the corners of the cell walls, these substances are deposited in the collenchyma tissue, okay, in the corners of their cells. And these are deposition of cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin. And that's why these cells have thickened corners. So in the corners, these substances are deposited. Intercellular spaces are absent here. In the parenchyma, small intercellular spaces were present, but here intercellular spaces are completely absent. So you can see here the diagram for the collenchyma tissue. Okay, you need to make all these diagrams of the parenchyma tissue as well as of the collenchyma tissue. Okay, you see here, this is collenchyma tissue. You need to make this diagram out of these. You make only this diagram. So see here, these are cells, okay, of collenchyma tissue, and you can see these thickened corners here, these red color portions. These are thickened corners present here, and these thickened corners are due to the deposition of cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin, right? This is protoplasm. And this central portion present here is vacuole. As you know, large vacuole is present in the plant cells. Central large vacuole. So this is central large vacuole. And this is cell wall. Okay. And you can see here, no intercellular space is present between the cells. These are also collenchyma cells here. Different shapes of these collenchyma cells are shown here. Okay. Because these are like the parenchyma cells. These collenchyma cells are also found in variable shapes. Now, function of collenchyma. They provide mechanical support to the growing parts such as young stem and petiole of a leaf. Okay, so function of collenchyma is to provide mechanical support. It provides mechanical support to the young stem and also to the petiole of leaf, the part of leaf with the help of which it is attached with the stem, as well as the complete petiole part of the leaf, that is the hanging structure in the air. Okay, and the cells that contain chloroplast assimilate food. So like parenchyma tissue cells, these cells of the collenchyma tissue also have chloroplast within. Okay, so the cells that contain chloroplast assimilate food also, so they also help in assimilation of food. Next type of simple permanent tissue is sclerenchyma. And sclerenchyma tissue, dead cells are present. So they are usually dead tissues without protoplast, because protoplast is a feature of living cells. Okay, if the protoplast is absent, it means these cells are dead cells. So we can say sclerenchyma is a dead tissue, right? Based on the form, structure, origin and development, sclerenchyma is of two types, fibers and sclerates. These are two types of sclerenchyma tissue. As you can see here in the diagram, this is a structure of fiber and this is structure of sclerate. Here you can see, in case of fiber, this lumen is present here. Okay, large sized lumen is present here and thick cell which is present here, and you can see the difference between the shape, a fiber and a sclerate. Okay, and here you can see this lumen, size of the lumen. You can compare the size of lumen in these two diagrams. Okay, and this part is pith and thick cell wall is present here in the sclerate also. Okay, now let's see about the features of fibers and sclerate. Fibers are having thick cell wall. Okay, these are elongated, as you can see the structure of fiber in the last in the previous slide. Okay, so elongated structure is present in case of fibers, and pointed cells. So cells are pointed, generally occurring in groups. And in case of sclerates, these are spherical. So you have seen the spherical structure of sclerate, right?
So these are spherical, oval or cylindrical. So different shapes can be formed. Highly thickened dead cells. So these fibers are also having thick cell wall, but the cell wall, thickness of cell wall of sclerates is more than the thickness of their cell wall, means of the fiber cell wall. Okay, so highly thickened dead cells with very narrow cavities, that is called lumen. You have compared the lumen also in fibers, large lumen is present, but in case of sclerates, narrow lumen is present, a narrow cavity that is called lumen is present here. Now sclerates are found in fruit walls of nuts, pulp of fruits like guava, pear and sapota is chiku, okay, seed coats of legumes and leaves of tea. So in all these sclerates are the sclerenchyma type of tissue is present, and that is dead tissue. Okay, so what is its function to be present here in these fruits? It provides mechanical support to organs. Okay, so function of sclerenchyma is to provide mechanical support to the organs of different fruits. Based on today's topics, your homework is NCERT question number 1, and you need to make all the diagrams which are described in today's lecture. Thank you.